Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. My name is Pontus, and I will talk about the work Visualizing Errors in Rendered High Dynamic Range, or HDR, Images. It's a work done by myself, Jim Nilsson, Peter Shirley, and Tomas Akenine-Möller. What we have observed is that rendering researchers and practitioners have no unified and accepted way of presenting errors in their HDR images. For example, a common way of presenting errors is by using tables of single error values, but these are often not sufficient to present the errors found in images. Instead, more emphasis should be put on the error map, which shows where and how large the errors are, and therefore provides a more complete picture about the algorithm's strengths and weaknesses. This was done in the recent flip work. However, the flip work focused only on low dynamic range, or LDR, images. During the coming minutes, we will present an approach to computing and visualizing the error in HDR images, which comes with additional challenges. We call it HDR Flip and hope that it will contribute to a unified way of presenting errors in HDR images. Now, let's begin by framing the problem. We make one key assumption, which is that the HDR images our renderers output will not be shown directly on an HDR display. Instead, they will be exposure compensated and tone mapped before they are shown to the observer. A simplified version of the pipeline is shown here. In this procedure, the exposure compensation has the largest impact on the displayed image. Next, we will illustrate this. Here we want to compare a high-quality reference image to a lower-quality test image. We use an approximation of the ASUS tone mapper and an exposure compensation factor of -3. We can see some noise in the blue inset in the bottom left, but in the yellow region, the reference and test look identical. We've now increased the exposure to 0. The situation is similar to before, with noise visible in the blue inset but not in the yellow. However, the noise in the blue inset is perceived differently at this longer exposure. Here, the exposure is increased to +4. We can no longer see any error in the blue inset, but we see large errors in the yellow one. So, different errors are seen depending on the exposure compensation we apply to the HDR image before displaying it. The challenge with HDR images is that the renderer developer seldom knows what exposure will be used when the HDR image is displayed. When the exposure is known, we can compute the perceived error between the LDR versions of the HDR reference and test images using the perception-motivated flip loss. Here, we denote it by LDR flip to make it clear that it is acting on LDR images. However, if we do not know the exposure, which we have shown has a significant impact on the displayed image, we have little knowledge of how the image will be perceived, and therefore about the error in it. Based on this, the idea of our metric is to compute the error view under several different exposures and then aggregate the results into a final error map. On the right, we have the reference and test images from the previous slide, together with the LDR flip error between them. In our approach, we store this map together with those from the other exposures. That is, we store the LDR flip maps seen on this slide. There is one for each exposure. Our proposed metric is then found by taking the per pixel maximum of each of the LDR flip images, as illustrated here. However, we use a denser grid of exposures, not just three. Since we take the maximum perceived error over many exposures, HDR flip represents the largest error an observer might perceive when the HDR image is displayed. A natural question is what range of exposures should be considered when computing HDR flip. We've set up an algorithm to compute the range automatically using the maximum and median luminance of the HDR reference image. This covers a range from not too dark to not too bright. What this means is, of course, subjective. Therefore, we provide the possibility to choose start and stop exposures manually for cases when the exposure range is known or when the user deems the automatically found exposure range to be too large or too small. As we take the maximum over several exposures, it might be interesting to know which exposure resulted in the maximum. We present this using what we call an exposure map, where the exposure that caused the largest error in a pixel is mapped to a color in the Viridis color map shown on the right. With this color map, longer exposures are mapped to brighter colors. For example, we see that errors on the library sign are perceived as largest under short exposures, since the exposure map is dark on the sign. Finally, we need to choose a color map for visualizing the error. This choice can have a significant impact on the interpretability of the presented error map. We use the magma map as it maps zero error to almost black and then increases in luminance as the error increases. An alternative would be the Viridis color map. The Viridis map would make the interpretation less intuitive, however, as one gets the impression that there are errors in the dark regions because they are not black. Now, let's compare HDR flip to other commonly used HDR metrics, namely the relative mean absolute error, the relative mean squared error, and the symmetric mean absolute percentage error. In this example, we show insets of the amusement park scene. They show LDR versions of the HDR reference and test images given at different exposures. In the bottom row are the LDR flip maps of each reference and test pair. We see how both the RMAE and the relative MSE fail to indicate error. SMAP is better, but has issues in the elliptical mirror in the top right of the inset, where it indicates small errors despite large ones being visible at long exposures. The HDR flip map correctly indicates all errors. Here, we show an inset of the subway scene. Again, only HDR flip correctly indicates the errors. SMAP shows larger difficulties in this example, as it doesn't indicate the large errors on the panel, which can be seen under longer exposures. In this next example, we look at the desk image, compressed with the BC6H algorithm. Here, we see how we also need to use shorter exposures to find the largest error that the HDR image might present when shown on an LDR display. Together, the three examples we presented show how the statistical metrics in many cases fail to represent the errors, while HDR flip succeeds. HDR VDP2 is another metric that has seen use in graphics research. We note that rather than depicting the magnitude of the error, the HDR VDP2 output shows the probability of detecting errors in the pixels. Like the other metrics we've compared to, however, it often fails to correctly depict the errors in HDR images, as it tends to indicate errors where none can be seen, and vice versa. This is exemplified here using the desk image. We see the same tendencies in other results generated with HDR VDP2. We referred to our supplemental material for the reference and test images corresponding to the set of outputs shown here. Let's now look at an example of how one could use HDR flip to compare algorithms. We assume that we have two different rendering algorithms, A and B. We also assume that we have done exposure compensation and tone mapping once, just to get familiar with the scene and get an initial impression of the output of the two algorithms. We see problematic areas in different regions of the images. The blue rectangle marks a problematic area for algorithm A, and the yellow rectangle marks a problematic area for algorithm B. The white rectangles mark an area where both algorithms seem to perform similarly based on these LDR versions of the HDR images. Let's have a look at the HDR flip and exposure maps. From the HDR flip results, we see how differently the errors from the two algorithms are distributed. The mean HDR flip error, however, is similar between the two. This is an example of why showing full error maps are important while comparing algorithms, as opposed to presenting only single values. The exposure maps tell us that we see large errors at several different exposures. Thus, since we have only looked at one possible LDR version of the HDR image, we have likely missed some important errors. If we look at the area marked with the white rectangles, we see large errors indicated there as well, even though we couldn't see any problems in the LDR versions we looked at before. The exposure maps imply that these errors are seen at longer exposures. Indeed, in these LDR versions where the exposure compensation is larger, we see that when the HDR image is displayed, an observer might see large errors in the white region as well. This example illustrates what we feel is the strength of HDR flip, that we can automatically detect errors that we might have otherwise missed. Now that we've looked at some results, we want to make a few notes on the HDR flip runtime. HDR flip requires one LDR flip computation per exposure. In our experiments, the automatically found number of exposures has usually been between 5 and 20. In our Python implementation, the runtime of LDR flip is about 4 seconds per 1080p image, resulting in HDR flip runtimes of about 25 to 90 seconds. We have implemented LDR flip in CUDA, and with that, the runtime is about 6 milliseconds per 1080p image, resulting in HDR flip runtimes of about 30 to 120 milliseconds. To conclude, we have presented HDR flip, which fills a gap in the rendering researcher's toolbox. You may find more details about the work and the code for HDR flip on the project page. Thank you.